Good morning and welcome. This is 10 years hence. Our speaker this morning is Gordon Gill, one of the world's preeminent exponents of performance-based architecture. His work, which ranges from the world's largest buildings to sustainable communities, is driven by his philosophy that there is a purposeful relationship between formal design and performance, and that there is a language of performance which is the basis of his practice. Form follows performance. A founding partner of the award-winning Adrian Smith and Gordon Gill Architecture, Gordon's work includes the design of the world's first net zero skyscraper, the Pearl River Tower, the world's first large-scale positive energy building, Masdar headquarters, the world's tallest tower, Kingdom Tower in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia, and most recently, the design of Astana Expo 2017 and its sustainable legacy community for Astana, Kazakhstan. These landmark projects pursue energy independence by harnessing the power of natural forces on site and striking a balance with their environmental contexts. Mr. Gill's designs also include performing arts centers, museums, strategic carbon planning, and urban master plans across the globe. His work has been published and widely exhibited in the U.S. and internationally, and his designs have been recognized by the American Institute of Architects. In 2013, he was elected to the College of Fellows for the American Institute of Architects. Prior to founding ASNGG in 2006, Gordon was an associate partner at Skidmore, Owings and Merrill, and a director of design for VOA Associates. Mr. Gill earned a Bachelor of Architecture degree from Ryerson University, as well as Master of Architecture degrees from the University of Texas at Austin and Harvard University. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Gordon Gill.
Good morning. If I speak like this, is that okay? Can you, is the audio fine? Okay. Well, thank you for inviting me today. I understand that this is part of a much broader lecture series that you'll be participating in over the next few weeks, months. And the purpose of this conversation today was really to think about the way that we think about sustainability in our office. We are an international architectural firm, architecture only. We work with a range of consultants to do our projects. We're in Chicago. We are in our 10th year. We started with five people in 2006 with some cardboard boxes and some hollow core doors. We ballooned up to about 200 in 2008. With enough work for about 1,000 people. So we had to go out and get some support, some help from other architectural firms. But that growth was a little too rapid for us, and we had a correction in 2008, as everyone will remember. That stopped a lot of projects, and we went back to about 100 people, 120 people, and we've been in that range ever since. We like that because we can tackle almost any scale project around the world. We have 50 buildings under construction. We do master plannings, urban cities, and we're probably most famous for our super tall work. They get a lot of attention when they come on the scene. But I think it's important for you to understand that we also have a tremendous amount of small scale projects. I'm going to show you a range of projects today and talk to you a little bit about the process that we use to design the buildings and some of the things that we've discovered or found over the last 10 years and what we'll be working on in the upcoming years. I'll start here. There is a book called The Machine in the Garden that was written by Theo Marx that I read decades and decades ago now when I was doing my thesis at Texas. And in the book, it speaks about a young man who sits on a hillside and he hears the whistle of a steam engine. and he realizes that his pastoral ideal, that landscape that he has come to love and understand, is disappearing. It's going to go forever because of the intervention of technology and the intervention of this transportation system that's going to rip through the countryside. I think if we understand that aspect of the relationship between nature and the built environment, and we think a little differently about our cities as primarily ecosystems, I would argue that today we have built ourselves this planet's most sophisticated barrier reef system for ourselves. We just don't quite know what to do with it yet. We have some understanding of it. We don't have a total understanding of it. I think the majority of the folks in the audience today are with the business school, some architectural students maybe, other professionals. But I'm going to lean this conversation towards the kind of economics around what we do. When we think of the cities, and we think of places like Chicago, which is obviously where we're from, we're constantly trying to strike this balance between the quality of life that we're creating for ourselves and the needs or lack of need that we have for buildings. This is what we're afraid of. And this is what we see as the scars that damage the landscapes across our country centuries or decades ago, I should say. And we're constantly moving towards something that we think is better, even though we can't exactly quantify it or define it. We see it in products all the time. All the time. You know, buy this product, it's organic. You know, I grew up in the Caribbean when I was a kid. Everything was organic. I didn't know what organic meant when I moved to North America, because what is not organic? but on the one side of that equation, we have our desire to be healthy and live a better life. On this other side of the equation, we have technology. And don't get me wrong, I love technology. I'm not good at it, but I love it. And so we end up with products like these. And this is where I said I might get in a little bit of trouble. But when we blend or merge the philosophy of efficiency with technology, we end up sometimes with something like this. Not exactly the car that I would choose to drive, but supposedly highly efficient. The problem that I have with this vehicle is that it's myopic in its solution toward the environment. It solves one single equation, and that is the efficiency of the fuel. I can go longer with less. That's it. Is that good? Yeah, it sounds good. But if I ask you what caused sprawl in this country in the first place, is it related to transportation? Was it that train? Was it the car? Was it Henry Ford? Was it the suburbs pop up because I could drive out to get my pastoral idealism 45 minutes out of town and then drive back in for work? Is that what caused all this? And let me see if I get this right. The answer today is to give me more of that? I'm not sure about that. The irony of all of this is something that you may or may not realize, which is if you think about the embedded or embodied carbon of that vehicle, and we had to study this when we did Mazda headquarters in Abu Dhabi, it's actually worse than a typical car. In other words, if you think about the process of making that vehicle, what it takes to make the batteries, what it takes to make the car, where that material is sourced from, what you do with the battery after it's dead, how do you get rid of it? Do you bury it? Do you burn it? What do you do with it? That problem, that life cycle problem as it relates to carbon, is actually worse than an average car. The vehicle on the right in this image was, a few years ago anyway, the most carbon-friendly vehicle on the planet. But if you ask most people what they want to drive, they'll tell you it's the vehicle on the left. The question is, why can't we have it all? Why can't we have both? And the reason I call this an uncompromised approach to sustainability is because I think it's very unfair to ask ourselves or others that we export our culture to do it with less. And when I say that, I mean a compromised lifestyle. What we need to do is figure out how to need less. If we need less, then we use less. And if I can maintain our lifestyle by needing less and not compromise, I don't have to wear a coat to sit at my desk to do my work because it's comfortable, then I think we might be onto something. So we just argue that what we need is a kind of common sense approach to technology and sustainability as it relates to the quality of life, which is ultimately why we're designing the buildings in the first place. When we started the firm, we did this little diagram 10 years ago. The top diagram is kind of the linear approach to architecture. Architects occupied the middle 6% of the decision-making process from when someone says, I think I might need a building, to opening that building and handing over the keys to the owner. We have a question about that in our office. We want to understand why that's the case. And so we've tried very hard to broaden that spectrum or that range of service that we deliver to our clients. In fact, today we get asked to come in and advise on projects even before they decide that they want a building or, you know, a space to move into. We also like staying longer. We call it the handshake at the ribbon cutting. When you cut the ribbon, you shake the hand of the owner, you say good luck with the building, and the architects disappear. We don't like that. What we want to do is we want to live with the buildings, we want to understand how they perform. Because if we are honest about it, we should be learning from our mistakes and solving them in the future when we do the next building. So we don't want to just walk away. I'm going to start here, and I'll go through these first two pretty quickly. This is the Pearl River Tower in Guangzhou, China, that designed as an associate partner of Skidmore, Owings & Merrill in Chicago to be the world's first net zero energy building. The building is formed or shaped the way it is because we had a basic problem. We had a broad-faced building on a site that was facing a tremendous amount of wind coming at it 78% of the time throughout the year. For super tall buildings, wind is the governing factor for the stability and structural issues related to those buildings. They move, they sway, they'll oscillate, they'll accelerate. Very uncomfortable, very dangerous. The really only solution that I could come up with was to puncture the building, to penetrate the building with four holes, two and two below, and actually move the wind through the body of the building and therefore alleviate the stress on the face of the building. But to do that, I had to understand some aerodynamics about the behavior of wind and created bell-shaped, let's say, vortices or slots through the building to alleviate that stress. And when we did that, we found out that we could accelerate that wind through those holes up to 13 times faster than with the wind that was going past the building. Now, when we did this, 13 years ago? I was told by the engineers that it wasn't going to work, that it didn't matter if you punched a hole in the buildings because wind just doesn't work that way. The building is just going to be what the building is. We had wind tunnel experts, because we do that for every super tall building that we do, and they said, it doesn't matter, it's not going to work. I said, please, just humor me for a second, just try it. After the tests came back, they came in and said, okay, we have a little problem. We have to go back and look at all the buildings we've done in the past because we're getting results on this that are very different than we've ever received on another building. Turns out that by doing this, even at 200 miles an hour gale force winds, this building is completely stable. It's in Guangzhou, China, so the typhoon winds are a tremendous issue. Now, understanding that and learning that was a huge move forward. Why? Because we were able to take out numerous tons of steel out of this building that the client was going to pay for that would have embedded carbon or embodied carbon in it. And we didn't need to use it in this building and yet we were able to maintain the performance. We got rid of all the mechanical space above the floor slabs. We have radiant ceilings in this building. And by dropping the floor to floor, but keeping the height 10 feet the same, because we don't have the mechanical space above, we were able to get 5 extra floors in this building. 100,000 square feet of space the client never expected to get. That's a tremendous value in the life cycle of this building. And I think what we want to get out of this is just that. We need to stop looking at first costs and start looking at life cycle costs. It's the same relationship between the myopic notion of just saving you gas and punishing you on the carbon side through the manufacturing of the vehicle. How do we actually get the unintended consequences of performance to be a life cycle issue? When we did Masdar headquarters in Abu Dhabi, we took those same principles and applied it to a 5-story building. 1 million square feet, 9 courtyards, completely passive in terms of the ventilation of those courtyards by understanding the convection related to that environment. 120 degrees ambient temperature, it's like opening a pizza oven, for those of you who have been there, extremely hot. How do you then protect and cool that building down and use the psychology of comfort for people who might be perspiring or ventilating space without pumping tons of air conditioning into the building? And the lesson here is that the first thing we need to do is take a passive approach to protecting the buildings or protecting the environment. Because if you can, and you can get that building to need less, then to get it to net zero energy or to get it to positive energy is much simpler. We hope that what you're seeing or what you understand from this is not about making the building less desirable. In fact, we would argue that you can make the building more desirable, more beautiful, more environmentally attractive, because ultimately we're doing it for people. And when we did this project, we had to understand the comfort psychology around the user. We had to test indigenous dress, international dress, casual dress, to ensure that the building was going to be comfortable throughout. The image on the right is the thermal model of the building on the inside, with that little red sliver being the outside plaza in front of the building. And you can see the differences there. In terms of the protection of the building, very well protected, but you, through the understanding of technology and how to use the wall systems, we can actually protect that building very, very well without creating a concrete block bunker that you have to work in. Because if we create a concrete block bunker, which frankly was the spec on the master plan, only 20% open concrete block, you would be working in the dark all day long. Ironically, the lighting system in the office is responsible for up to 35% of the load. So you're going to pay for that artificial light all day long. Meanwhile, you're in the desert and you couldn't ask for more sun. So it's not a question of light, it's a question of heat. So I want the light, but I got to keep the heat out. And so we actually designed an exterior wall that performed better than the concrete block wall, but increased the daylight into the building so that we could decrease the artificial lighting load. Again, the entire system relationship, that kind of pluralistic relationship. What I'm doing somehow has an effect on what you're doing has an effect on what they're doing. This kind of pluralistic approach we think is critical to solving the problems. So we don't believe in siloed approaches to solving problems. In 2008, when things stopped, we took 50 of our folks and we went up to the city and we tried to figure out what all this noise was about signing up for the 2030 challenge. The mayor signed up for it, governors were talking about it, everybody around the world was excited about it. It's a fantastic thing. So this is great, this is amazing. So we ran over to the city and said, oh great, great, how are we gonna do this? How do you do this? Went to 14 different departments in the city. Nobody could tell us how they were actually gonna do it. Nobody knew how to get to the 2030 challenge, a reduction of 39 million metric tons of carbon in, what, 15 years? Something like that. Or 22 years. They couldn't figure it out. So we wrote a book. We wrote a 280-page book. We published it. And it's basically the steps to get to net zero or low-carbon cities. And if you think about the buildings as a set of interrelated systems, and you unpack those systems and then put them back together in mutually supporting ways, you can do the same thing with the cities. So what we basically did was dissected the city. We broke it down into a series of components, and then we repacked it so that they were interrelated to each other. What does the sewer have to do with retail? What does density have to do with transportation? What does density have to do with energy? So on and so forth. Technology would be easy. We can spend $2.3 billion and build a wind plant, a turbine plant out in the suburbs somewhere, take the entire city off the grid. Or we could do a solar farm, put it out on a lake, take the entire city off the grid. The problem with that is you really haven't solved the problem in the city. If you're really thinking of solving the needs of people, you're not going to do it by simply pushing technology on it. We can pump air conditioning into this space all day long to keep it at 68 degrees. It's probably not the smartest thing to do, but that's what we do because we can use the technology to do it. But is there a better way to do it? There probably is. We studied 40 million square feet in the core. This is our core back then. The red is office, so 90% office or so in the core. That little yellow corner is residential, Lakeshore East, 10 million square feet of residential. But you'll notice that there's one school proposed, actually wasn't built. There's no mixed use in the core. And so what we did was we repurposed the existing building stock. 90% of this country's energy issue is related to existing building stock. New buildings, as much as we love them, are only about 3%. So you can design all the net zero new buildings you want. What are you going to do with that 97% of existing buildings? That's where the problem is. That's an economy. That's a business. Because there are very few people that understand the economics around leveraging existing building stock as valuable assets more than just cost per square foot. Because every building has a latent potential in it. When we modeled the mixed-use core, we found, obviously, that because residential uses a quarter of the energy that office space uses, the carbon footprint was dropping. So we like mixed-use cores. We like mixed-use cities. We tackled the mobility networks. We looked at infrastructure. We liberated the streets so that there'd be nice walkable spaces. This is actually the street in front of our office, Monroe Street, for those of you who know Chicago. And we tackled energy, gas. We looked at water use. You might understand that infrastructure leaks, extremely wasteful. You might understand that when energy is produced, only something like 30% of it actually gets to your building, because 70% of it is wasted between where it's created and how it gets to you. We looked at education and social programs of how to teach people about energy. My kids now harass me about leaving my phone plugged in when I'm not using it. And we leveraged the building stock. What do we do with all this existing buildings? Ironically, we were asked to look at what was then the Sears Tower, what is now the Willis Tower. And we were asked to design a net zero energy hotel adjacent to the Willis Tower on the same site. I said, well, we don't think that's really practical given the cost of energy in Chicago, but what have you done with the existing building? 4 million square feet, 1976, single pane glass. That's the size of a small little city. And we found rather quickly that the emissions, carbon emissions of that building was one SUV per year per piece of glass, per window. 9,000 windows in that building. That's a lot of carbon. We unpacked the building, we analyzed everything we could. And we found pretty quickly that we could save a tremendous amount of energy in that building, the equivalent of which would be, in some cases, up to 20,000 single-family homes off the grid every year. So if you could renovate one building that was 4 million square feet and take 20,000 single-family homes off the grid every year, would you do it? Maybe. Because the savings to your infrastructure would be huge, tremendous. Look at the 40 million square feet of buildings that we're analyzing in the core, and what would that mean to the residential neighborhoods around Chicago? What's the value of that energy? If you have a building that's saving energy, and you have an ability to shift that building, that energy, to the building next door, is there a value in that? There has to be, and there is. And there are a lot of people who talk about carbon stock exchanges and shifting energy. But the guys that are most interested in this, ironically, are the utility companies. I got a call from ComEd. ComEd says, hey, I understand you're putting 500,000 square feet of hotel. Yes. And so let's talk about increasing that substation that's on site there. Well, actually, we don't need to increase the substation. Yeah, you do. You have to. You can't just put a building in the city and not bring energy to it. Well, what if we did? So I asked them. I said, how much do you spend every year on upgrading your infrastructure to service the people in Chicago? Hundreds of millions of dollars. I said, what if you didn't have to spend that money, but you could still service the community? Would you do it? All of a sudden, I had a friend. I had this guy on the other side of the phone who all of a sudden wanted to understand what that equation was. And the equation is actually quite simple. So here you have the utility companies that would love to save money and still provide power to their customers. Here you have building stock that's available to be renovated. Why can't we get this done? It has a lot to do with policy. It has a lot to do with leadership. It has a lot to do with the education and understanding from the top down. Because unless you're able to actually move that energy across town, because underneath the streets is full of infrastructure, they're all connected, we are all connected, but we don't think that way. We have silos of buildings. So we proposed this. Mayor loved it, owner loved it, and so we began a small program with them. We didn't get too far because they actually increased the rental in the Willis Tower from like 60% to 90%, not solely because of us, but because of a host of things. And then they sold it. So today you'll see other things going on over at Willis. But the lesson was great because the city has now kind of taken this on and moved this toward neighborhood development strategies. We went out and thermally photographed every building. It was a challenge because whenever you go to a building and ask somebody to give you their utility calcs or their expenditure, they immediately think you're up to something. You're immediately suspicious. So that part of the education process took a long time. The DOE helped us with it. The reason I wanted to go through this a little bit and talk to you about it was because there's a whole new era of technology out there that can support this stuff. This clip is actually 8 years old now. It's a clip of a virtual model of the core of Chicago. But what we did was we created data for every building and allowed you to run scenarios by simply changing the parameters of each building. When you do that, what we're looking at is the overall performance of carbon in that core, in that model. And if you could do that, you would understand the relationship between a much larger bundled approach to energy and carbon than you would if you just did one building at a time. But somebody needs to understand how to manage this. Now, we've been maturing this tool to some degree over the last 8 years. We actually use this tool to help us with planning strategies now, because who wouldn't want a real-time analysis or monitoring of the environmental issues associated with their built environment? Everybody would like that. It's a Fitbit for a city. So now what we learned from this project was that we could actually push the carbon down. We needed about 20% renewable energy at the end to get to the challenge, to make it all the way, but that was okay. That was easy to accommodate. And our lesson from it was really that increased density is good. Everything gets more efficient. The more compact, the better. The relationship is, the question becomes, what's the quality of life in that environment? You don't want to overdo it, because we still want to live properly, have beautiful parks, be able to take our kids for walks on beautiful streets. And so it's this constant balance between the built environment and the open space. We created apps for owners to go in with the DOE and CMAP to understand and check the buildings. And all of this we took overseas. So when we got asked to design a city in Chengdu for 100,000 people, 6 million square meters, 60 million square feet of space, and we were given 7 square kilometers to do it in, we used 1/7 of the land because we made it more compact, walkable, 1 kilometer in diameter, transit at the center, and we modeled everything. We modeled the solar impact on every surface of the city. There's a guy in our office who wrote the ladybug program to test the solar gain or daylight on the windows. We modeled the wind because we want to make sure that it's comfortable. We kept the agricultural land, kept the people that were there. We didn't displace them. But the story really is that the planners in Chengdu didn't trust the developer and, frankly, us. They weren't sure what we were up to. So they gave us the 7 square kilometers out there on the fringes. You go out there and do your thing. We spent 4 years. We did about 9 books on this subject. We presented it, and after a while, we got a phone call from the head planner. He said, look, this is making a lot of sense to us. Why don't we move that project into the city? And they gave us a project called Tianfu, which is a part of the new city connected to Chengdu. We planned it, and it's under construction today. We have about 3 or 4 of these under construction today. Mixed use, which was a lesson we learned from Chicago. 1/7 of the land, just some metrics on it. And we'll see what happens over time. This one is interesting. It says, so it's 94% less waste. Dr. Chris Drew, who's our head of sustainability, was our client at Masdar. And then he jumped ship and came to work with us after we finished the project. And he said at the time that they were recycling 97% of their waste. I said, that's fantastic, congratulations. He said, no, that's absolutely horrible. I said, how could it be horrible if you're recycling 97% of your waste? He said, because we have 97% of waste to recycle. The key is to not have any waste, not to recycle it. That's good, but you're missing the point. I said, oh, of course. So what we're trying to do here is become a lot more efficient in the way that we think about designing places and designing buildings. That led us to this. I'll go through this. See, how am I doing there? How am I doing? Half hour or so? This is Kazakhstan, Astana. For those of you who have not been there, it's an extremely hostile climate. Extremely cold. New capital city for Kazakhstan. 150 people entered this competition for the World's Fair 2017. This project is under construction, will be finished in June of this year. 23 buildings, 6 million square feet. We worked for an entire summer, almost killed all of us. We delivered a 400-page document, and we won the competition. Why did we win the competition? We won because that little circle that you see in the bottom right-hand corner, it's about 25 hectares of land where the expo itself is going to occupy. They're going to spend somewhere between $4 and $6 billion US to build an expo for 13 weeks. Didn't make any sense to us. We realized that they own all the land around it. They owned 1.4 kilometers by 1.4 kilometers of land. And what they were going to do with it was they're going to put parking on it. Put all the parking on there for 13 weeks. Everybody would go away and we'll figure out what to do with the land afterwards. We said, all right, we're gonna propose a mixed-use neighborhood. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna design this neighborhood for the city, and then we're gonna use it for the expo for 13 weeks. So your investment will be for the life cycle and legacy of the city, but you'll just use it, we'll reverse engineer it for the 13-week expo. So we parcelized it, we put residential, retail, schools, there's a university nearby, there's a medical hospital nearby, power plant, so on and so forth. They sold all the residential to developers. We wrote all the guidelines for it. They brought their costs way, way down. And all of a sudden, we have this kind of ecologically sound environment that people can live, play, work in. And what I've heard is that the banks are now signed up to move into the buildings in that circle to create a new international business center, the heart of the center of which is a museum. So we introduced art museums, theaters, cultural programs as part of this. So we wanted a rich mixed-use environment. This is an old aerial. I was there, Bob Forrest, our management partner, and I were there a couple months back, and it's almost all done. Very happy, looking great. Again, we do the analysis. Sometimes we overanalyze. The guy who ran this ran something like 3,976 different iterations of solar analysis. We said, that's great, we just want three. Just give us the top three. That's what we work with, and the reason we work with that is because, unlike Abu Dhabi, even though the principles are solar, what we're trying to do here is absorb the heat because it's cold. I think the average temperature in the summer is something like 58 degrees. We all bought these big fat goose down coats, Canada Goose coats, to go in, to go to Astana in the winter. It was great. We all walk around them. We're like Michelin men out there. We get to the airport, walk outside. The coats are rated to minus 50 degrees Celsius. Walk out, it's minus 51. I couldn't believe it. Colder than the rating of the coat. The guy in the car had to keep the car running because he can't shut the car off because of a freeze. And his perspiration, his expiration, was freezing inside the car. There was ice all over the back seat, all over the floor, everything. They move the snow with bulldozers. They can't use salt because it's too cold. They use sand. The bulldozers move the sand all over the place. It's a mess, extremely harsh. There's a park that links the site to the city. We created a new planting program for the entire city. We looked at all the metrics like we did in Chicago, and we designed it to be a low carbon, efficient, mixed use environment. One of the jokes was that after we won the competition and came in with this beautiful little building in the center, and when we started to talk to them about designing this, we were working with the building department. The building department said, you can't do that. You can't do that here. To get the permit, you can't do that. So we went to the prime minister. The prime minister said, yeah, well, go and talk to the building department. So we went to the president. And the president said, yeah, I understand it. Let's do it. So, well, we're being told we can't do it. So he wrote a law. Called up the lawyers, called up the prime minister, wrote a law. This is how we're going to do it. And that was the basis of the delivery for the systems and the project. Policy, right? In this particular case, singular dictator, this is the way it's going to be. We're all excited. We're all happy. On the way out, he says, oh, by the way, you know that building you have in the center there? That, yeah, I said, yes, because I would like a sphere there instead. Just give me an 80-meter sphere there instead. So we're like, yeah, fantastic. Every expo has a sphere. In this particular case, we thought we would actually make it a full sphere. For those of you who have ever seen any of these things, they look like soccer balls. They're faceted. They're flat faced. We said, we're not going to do that. We're going to do double curved glass. We designed this, we raised it up, and we designed a double curved glass. You're looking at the base of it right now in renderings. It's connected to a kind of retail mall concept in the center. It has two large atria that use convection to move it around. We did all the analysis, of course. We're pretty creative with materials, so we use regular flat glass, and we bend flat glass when we're designing the lower portion of it. But for the actual skin, we had to go out and find double curved insulated glass to design the sphere. We thought that was going to be pretty straightforward because every car has double curved glass and a windshield. We just wanted insulated. There were three people on the planet that we found that could do it. So we spent a year and a half flying around talking to these people, and ultimately we figured it out and got them to do it. It's much greener in this image than it will be when it's done because there's a protective backing on it, so there's no light passing through that glass right now. But it's almost done. All the buildings are under construction. All the structure was in. I mentioned to you that there was some pretty brutal conditions there when it gets cold. So I really take my hat off to all the people who work on these kinds of projects in environments that we have no clue what they're doing out there while we're, you know, tucked away drawing and designing. There are a pair of turbines at the top of this building. I want to be clear about that in terms of the energy efficiency of those turbines. The energy efficiency of turbines embedded in buildings is very low. On Pearl River, there are four turbines in those slots. That's not why those slots are there. That's the secondary reason why they're there. The primary reason was to get the steel out of the building, get the building to behave properly. In this particular case, because it's an expo and an exhibition, they like the turbine concept. We designed it to be in there, and those are being constructed and delivered. There you see kind of the overall ghost of that circle we talked about, and then becoming more built up. Some of the theaters and exterior walls that shed snow and shed ice, the idea of creating support space for photovoltaics that generate power for the buildings. And all of this is going on as we speak. We designed facades for the expos that could be planted and then relocated in parks and reused for playgrounds. Again, the discipline of being precise, hopefully, and accurate between what you represent and what is built is important because you're not going to get the performance out of it if it's built differently than what you designed. So I won't tell you that these guys are 100% perfect, but they did a pretty good job. They cut back on certain things because of their loss of value in their currency because of oil, but overall, we were pretty happy with where they have gone. It's important for you to understand that a lot of these buildings that you see have budgets. One of the issues that we come across, and people tell us all the time, yeah, that's nice, but we could never do that here because, you know, we don't have like sheikhs or presidents that, you know, spend eternal money and just throw money at stuff. Not true. Everybody has a budget. And some of the budgets and projects that we do are pretty tight. They're big, and so there's an economy of scale, so we can be creative with those budgets, but they're pretty tight. Masdar headquarters costs less per square foot than a suburban US post office. And it's positive energy. There's no excuse why we can't do this. We just have to figure it out, get it done. Formally, the performance issues are related to absorbing, shedding, protecting, reducing, movement, social issues, psychology of comfort as it relates to dappled light, versus just solid. And so these spaces are assessed, hopefully, on those aspects as we walk through and design the spaces. There's a whole host of people in our office that are very adept at technology and analysis and research. And they have hackathons in the office that they play with and create new solutions to problems that we're trying to solve. This is something that's very near and dear to my heart in terms of the making of buildings. So if you're going to create something, you should at least understand how it needs to be made in order to design it properly. Then we can have fun with what we make. Because we realize that the knock-on effects of what we do is you can model infinity behind walls to create color and light to show density versus on occupancy or like light. We can do all kinds of things with products that we create. I mean, reason that's important is because this goes back to the expanse of the spectrum of empathy. We don't need to just think about it in our own way, but we can affect other industries in terms of what we're asking the environments to do. Today we're designing zero carbon buildings in Canada, and we have an entire procurement process that's associated with achieving that zero carbon, because you have to source the materials properly, so we challenge those who are producing and delivering. What I just showed you was a building that, a master plan that was basically from scratch. But I told you also that the real issue is with the existing building stock. It's kind of fortuitous that we were invited to speak with you here, because we've been back and forth to South Bend over the last few years on a regular basis. And I see our client, Kevin Smith, sitting there. So I have to be careful what I say. But nonetheless, there's a kind of amazing opportunity that we have here on many levels. I would argue that almost every city in the United States is struggling with what to do with their existing building stock. And many of them have industrial areas that either are decayed or are now transformed. That technology is transformed and they're abandoned. But they occupy typically extremely valuable land, either in the center of the city for distribution, or many times on the waterfronts, as they do in Toronto or as they did in Chicago. And they're the most coveted spaces. When we got this project and talked to Kevin about it, we began to see a very interesting dynamic, a very interesting platform that was available here. If we discuss the notion of creating a district as an ecosystem and connect it to the larger ethos of South Bend, we could essentially reprogram what is the Studebaker factory campus south of here and create... Did I do that? That was like the magical create, the wand of creativity. Create an environment or a platform for mixed use program and uses that currently either don't exist or aren't finding an avenue to exist in South Bend. You know, data centers, for example, are fairly interesting projects. So we talked about that. And everybody thinks of data centers as those dead spots in the cities or those dead spots in the building. However, they give off tremendous amount of heat. They generate heat. And if you can use that heat to power energy for the rest of the project, you actually have a built-in little battery pack for the buildings. So that's what we started to look at. The kind of relationship that have how people move or back and forth between the core and the south side of the tracks, literally the other side of the tracks, was very interesting to us, creating gateways, connectivity, the notion that the psychology of that barrier should be kind of healed, as opposed to creating this difference between the north side and the south side. But repurposing these buildings, I think there's at least 1 million square feet of buildings down there that could offer a whole new perspective on what I consider to be a national problem is very important. And it's very important to you as a city, because I think there are very few examples in this country that do it right, that do it well. What people need are examples, things that they can look at, things that they can quantify, things where the economics behind it are valid, the social aspects are valid, the architecture and planning is valid, and now they learn how to solve these problems. It's spotty in the US. You can go to some cities and see it. We struggle with it in Chicago, to be perfectly honest. We applied the entire system or arsenal of analysis that we use on every project to this campus. Everything down to the glass in the exterior wall system, or the idea that we can create a consistent expression of a building, but with with new technology that is far more efficient. Environmental spaces in the courtyards in between that are beautiful for people to use and occupy when the weather is nice, or maybe if we shade it or cover it when the weather is not nice. The notion of art and beauty is important to us. I don't want you to think that we're accountants. We're not. We have a discipline and a rigor around the economics of what we do, as well as we do for the sustainable and energy issues. But in the end, the trick for us is to make places that are beautiful. And if we can't do that, frankly, we're failing. Nobody's going to want to live there if it's not beautiful. We've had a tremendous amount of discourse back and forth about landscape and creating the kind of stitched green belt systems or green avenues that go over to the river and over to the city, and also the kind of uses that may be needed in South Bend, where we can have mutually supportive programs between schools such as yours, for example, and what might be happening on this campus. We see these things as mutually beneficial. We see everything as mutually beneficial. We don't believe, as I said before, in working in isolation. So the concept that we could create interior spaces that would support programs for the school or research and development programs, spaces for homeless that may need support or that may need education to get reinvigorated back into the workplace or the environment, we think there's ample opportunity for those types of programs to occur in South Bend. I know that Kevin personally has some pretty large visions for what can come to this place, but I don't think they're any smaller than what you expect from your school. I think there are amazing things. I was upstairs talking to the dean a while ago, and it was a 15-minute conversation, but it was fantastic, because the kind of questions that he was asking me were clearly not about where he thought he needed to be today. It was about where he thought he needed to be in 10, 15, 25 years. And I love that. We believe that we can create environments that are fantastic, hopefully. But we don't do it in isolation. There's a lot of consultants, a lot of people working on the project. There'll be more coming in. And we have a lot of excitement about the potential for, frankly, this city as a model and this project as an example. We did the same thing in Nashville for towers, and I want to make sure that you understand that although we have small scale projects, we have some pretty big scale projects. This was a building that we did for a client in Nashville. I'm just going to move through this pretty quickly so I can get to the last two projects, which are super tall towers in China and in the Middle East. But what you should notice about this project is that it's trying to overcome an issue in the grid. It's torqued. It's moved. If you ever take a potted plant, put it in a spot where it's not getting a lot of light, and come back over time and watch it move around to kind of find the best position so that it can strike that balance between what it needs to live and the size of that pot. That kind of understanding of the ecology of buildings is important to us. And what I'm going to tell you is that as much as we love buildings, we love the planning side and the city side as much. Because if the master plan isn't done properly, what we're essentially doing as architects is overcoming deficits of performance from the plan in order to make the buildings work right. So what we look at is how to plan spaces, plan cities intelligently. And the purpose of that is in order to move everything to need less. This building was in Seoul, Korea, where they were 10 days ago and looked at it. It's the headquarters building for FKI, Federation of Korean Industries, a Fortune 500 type of group that houses those industries and supports them in this office. It's 50 stories. The analysis, as you see, for thermal load, but there's an equation here that you should be aware of. This building has a photovoltaic facade. Why? Because in Seoul at that time, they paid you up to 8 times the amount of energy that you created on your building. So it made perfect sense to lace this with photovoltaics. That's been changed. We were there 2 weeks ago, as I mentioned, and that policy is gone. But this building has been grandfathered in. So timing was great. But what we did with this building was to kind of understand the performance issues on the exterior wall of how to get as much photovoltaics on this building, but still create a beautiful environment for people to work in. So we put it on the walls, on the facades of the building, not as sunshades, but we integrated it into the wall. But when we looked at the wall, what we're really trying to do is understand how could we make the wall better. So we took a standard piece of glass and tipped it at 14.9 degrees, not 15, because at 15 it's a code issue and you have to laminate the glass, it becomes a skylight. So 14.9999 degrees. Held it there to reduce the angle of incidence from the sun that heats up that wall, and create a return spandrel on the top where the photovoltaic is facing up and getting the sun. Why did we do that? Just because of the photovoltaics? No. If you've ever looked at the airports and seen the control towers with the glass that looks like that, there's two reasons why that's like that. One is that they want a clear perspective of the tarmac. They want to see all the stuff that's moving around down there. The other is glare. They can't afford to have glare in the eyes of the controllers when the planes are landing. So this move takes angle of incidence off the surface of the glass and cuts the glare. Most of our clients are asking for floor-to-ceiling glass in their office building. Have you ever walked into an office building when the sun's out and seen all the shades pulled shut? One reason is heat, but the other reason is because everybody works on computers and you can't see the screen if there's glare. So what's the point of having floor-to-ceiling glass if I have to pull the shades because I can't see my computer? So those relationships between the way that people work and what's being requested because it's fantastic views, those two things don't always match up. In this building, they do. So well, in fact, that we've actually used this wall as a kind of prototype for some of our buildings. When we don't have orientation to the sun, we take the PV out and we get indirect glass, indirect light into the spaces. The wall looks like that. What's interesting about the wall is that because it's tipped down, when you approach the building, what you see is the ground plane, you see behind you because it's tipping down at you, and then you see the sky. So the building actually has a little bit of a transformation as it moves upward. At the top of the building, we created a garden. It looks nothing like this now. There 2 weeks ago, there's a restaurant beneath this floor, at the top of the building, and they went up here and they planted a farm to grow vegetables for the garden. It's great. Not aesthetically great, but it's a beautiful thing. There's hoes, wheelbarrows, kids running around up there in the summer when it's cool. But the reason they were able to do that was because we understood that for us to have a garden, we need to bring that exterior wall up to protect the winds whipping through there because it killed the trees. But we left the top open like a trellis and created photovoltaics on the top and had the dapple light coming in, which you see on the left side of that image on the wall. And it's a very comfortable, psychologically comfortable, and physically comfortable space. So comfortable that it can grow carrots and potatoes and tomatoes. So we had lunch there. It was pretty good. For dinner, it's a 1 month wait. So it's popular. We like that. We like it when things make economic sense. We like it when our clients succeed. We don't want them to compromise. We want them to win. We design our buildings so that you can win in whatever aspect you choose to pursue. When we talk about the economics behind projects like this, and we understand that there are things such as the conference center associated with the building, we have an aesthetic that we use with the performance issues. But you may have remembered I told you about using flat glass and bending flat glass. While this is curved, it is actually just flat glass, bent 2 inches either way to get the curve. So we can create amazing geometries with standard equipment. We don't have to ask anybody to make something special. We just have to think about how to use standard stuff and make it special. Same thing is true with the systems. Same thing is true with the cities. Same thing is true with almost everything we touch. You're in the business school. I argue for the universities that we teach at and work at that we should take the architecture students, introduce them to the business school, get the school of policy in there, get the urban designers in there, and do projects together. Because everybody learns from everybody else. We have never done a project in isolation. Everybody is involved all the time. So why wouldn't we be learning that way? And that was one of the conversations I just had upstairs. Same thing is true for every project we do. This is the Waldorf Astoria in Beijing. I will tell you that when we started this project, we had some challenges with the facade and the aesthetic, but the Forbidden City is just to the right of this building, about a kilometer and a half, you can see it. But one of the issues that we have with buildings is that when you just design a flat wall, you can't see down the street. You can only see perpendicular to that wall. What would you do in a hotel to enhance the experience of the visitor? You could create a bay window, you could punch it out, you could move it up, you could put more glass in it. But the purpose really is, what's your point of view? So what we did was we created a rotated bay that's different on every facade in order to get you in your room to see the best views out of that room. Think of it as a compound eye. Think of it as the idea of increasing your perspective or your periphery in order to see more with less. Standard glass, standard system. Very successful project. Just a little fact, you see those doors at the entry? They're 15 feet tall, there's two of them. Each one weighs a ton. But you take your finger, push it open. Because of the hinge system and the mechanism in there. Why does it weigh a ton? It weighs a ton because this project is in a proximity to the Forbidden City, and the chairman was very sensitive about the antiquities of this district. And he told us, I want a building that feels stable, feels solid, but relates to the antiquity. How can you do that? Stone, what would you do? We went for a walk one day at lunch, and we walked up the street, and up the street, one of the most famous hospitals in China. And when the director and I, he was working on the project, we went to the gate, he was explaining to us the hospital. In the front of the hospital are these two huge bronze urns, beautiful, massive urns, heavily carved, beautifully done, and you can see where people would walk up and touch them, rub them, and the oils from their hands would polish the urn in a certain spot, and the rest of it would be patinaed. Immediately, what we're looking at is a memory of time, history, a place that we know millions have passed before us. And so we said, why don't we do that for the hotel? Millions will pass through these doors. Why don't we create a scale and a quality of this environment that people will remember, but we can mark it with time when they open the door, when they touch the handle. But it needs to feel powerful. So we went back and we said, hey, chairman, what do you think about doing this building out of bronze? We figured there's no way he's gonna make this building out of bronze. There's no way. We meet every 3 weeks. He said, let me think about it. We leave, come back in 3 weeks. He said, so I had a meeting with the mayor, had lunch with the mayor. I told him we're gonna do a bronze building. He loved it. We give each other little high fives under the table. And now we have to figure out how to make this building bronze. We're not afraid of what we might not know today, but we have the ability to figure it out. If we just sit here and just do what we did yesterday, we're pretty much destined to failure. But we tried, and he took it, and we figured it out. Today, this building is so successful that the client finds competitors walking around in the lobby taking pictures. They love that because they get to throw them out. But they also know that they have a product that's coveted. They have a gem, highly efficient, new experience, high quality, and the life cycle of it is fantastic. We're going to publish another book probably this year, right? This year. And that book is about the relationship between density and carbon footprint. So we spent 2.5 years now looking at the relationship for residential buildings from super, super tall, 200 stories, all the way down to single family homes and suburban homes. And we have found that the carbon footprint of the tall towers is related to land use because you're using less land. So if you're generating either energy on that land or food on that land, the relationship of the carbon and the density when you're spreading out 2,000 homes across several hundred acres versus putting it into one building, that equation needs to be understood because, again, it's life cycle. Of course, the answer is somewhere in the middle in terms of what's the best building for residential, somewhere in the neighborhood of 30 to 60 stories. But what's interesting is when you start using the land again for food or power or whatever else, the carbon footprint swing changes tremendously. The dense buildings come down, and the suburban sprawl development stays up. So we know that when we plan cities, we should try and avoid that kind of spread, and we should be focused more on density. Last two projects, Wuhan Tower in China, just to show you some of the big guys, because they're popular. 636 meters, mixed use, hotel, residential, office, formed intentionally to increase its performance and reduce redundancy in its structure. Three-legged tripod structure, very strong, but also 120 degrees in between each wing, so you're not looking into your neighbor when you stay look out of your apartment. Ventilated, like Pearl River, to reduce the wind forces. And as I mentioned, rich in program. Structurally efficient. And what we're finding these days is that groups like Ritz-Carlton come to us and say, you know, those vents that you put in the building, we understand that they're not freely for us, but can we use them? Can we put suites adjacent to these and get people out there? I say, absolutely. We just need to understand what the negative pressure is there so you don't get blown off or sucked off the balcony. Well, they do it. So we do. Don't be afraid. There's a science behind it. We understand that we need to put you in a safe and comfortable environment, but we also understand that if we give you an opportunity to have an experience that you've never had before, you'll remember that for the rest of your life. And so that's what we try to do. When we design these things and we make them safe and comfortable, we create spaces, especially at the tops of these buildings, that we hope are unique. We never give the top of our buildings to the mechanical floor, ever. We give them to the people who use them because they can be amazing. When I go to these buildings, that's where I want to be, on the roof. I want to see everything. I want a different perspective on life, literally. So we create environments such as this. Same thing with the arrival, just like we did at Waldorf Astoria. We create rooms, exterior rooms, for you to pull up and be safe and comfortable. The building kind of hugs you when you show up. It's not those little mean slivers of canopies that do nothing. I'm moving here pretty quickly because I know that I'm going to run out of time, and I want to make sure if I answer questions. This building is under construction, obviously. It's one of our 50. Exterior walls going up, but sometimes we see things that we couldn't predict, really. We get beautiful moments that stay with us and encourage us to just keep working. That's the stage of construction right now. It's about, let's call that, a little more than halfway up. And in contrast, we have this guy. This is Kingdom Tower in Jeddah. This will be the world's next tallest building. It's over a kilometer in height, mixed use. Those of you who know Chicago, you can take two Sears Towers, stack them up. It's actually not as tall as this building. Tremendous amount of technology and science going behind this. So the forearm, again, tripod, very slender. The wind behavior characteristics were important. The formal aspects are important. The wind tunnel tests were tuning this building all the way through. But there's one little story that you won't hear that I'm going to tell you, actually two. One is this. I don't know if any of you remembered that there was a building in London that fried a Jaguar a couple summers ago. Guy comes up, goes to the building, parks his Jaguar outside, runs inside, does his transaction, comes back out, toast. Why? Because the architect that designed it didn't understand that that building was shaped in such a way that it was concentrating heat at one spot out there on the sidewalk, and he cooked that guy's car. When I was in school in Toronto in the 80s, early 80s, the Royal Bank of Canada built their new headquarters building. Gold glass, because that's what you did to show that you had money. And it reflected all the heat into the building across the street. Unfortunately, that building was the Bank of Montreal. They heated up the Bank of Montreal to the point where they had to replace the mechanical system, and the Bank of Montreal sued the Royal Bank of Canada, and they had to pay for the mechanical system. I remember that. It was kind of sweet justice. But you have to understand that, because if you don't, you'll fry the guy's car. So what did we do when we designed this building? We had to understand that what we were doing was creating a kilometer-high reflective surface, concave, the angle of incidence. The sun in Jeddah is at 88 degrees. What are we doing? At the time when we were doing this, we hadn't heard the story about the Jaguar yet. We just did it because we knew we had to understand it. Turns out that we were doing the same thing. We were focusing that heat, and basically what we've designed is the world's tallest solar concentrator. What do we do with it? We use it to the building's greatest advantage. We increased the lobby, we put a canopy on the top, and we laced it with photovoltaics and hot water to create power and hot water for the building. We have to understand the unintended consequences, or hopefully they're not unintended. We understand it and the life cycle issues associated with it so that we actually can improve the conditions. We're not going to cook you when you go into the building. Same thing happened on this project with the prince, as did with the president in Astana. We designed the building, and the prince Al-Waleed is in the meeting, and he says, this is fantastic. Can you put a helicopter up there, helicopter pad up there, on the 180th floor? If you think about that, the wind behavior characteristics up there are tremendous, dangerous. So we looked to his cabinet to kind of explain to him that this is probably not the best idea in the world. And they all look at the prince and go, absolutely. We can do that for sure, no problem. So we're devastated. Walk out of the room, and now we have a problem. What do we do with the prince's helipad? We know we can't land a helicopter up there. So we put his Magilis up there. We put a Magilis up there for him to be able to walk out onto a platform 2,000 feet up in the air and look down on the master plan. It's his space. We put him in a position where he'd have an experience that he couldn't have anywhere else. And we prayed that he would accept it instead of asking for the helicopter pad. And he did. He loved it. What you need to know about this is that in order to build these buildings, the science behind them are very complicated. The concrete in these buildings are like water because you have to pump the concrete 3,000 feet up into the sky. Very, very fluid conditions. You also have to stage all the equipment. What you need to realize about the scale of this, let me see if I can find that, is that above that platform is the height of Sears Tower. You're just about not even two-thirds of the way, a little more than halfway. When we talked to the construction guys, they said, if you can design this thing where we can use this for staging and put materials out there to get the next 1,500 feet, we're all for it. So we had multiple reasons why this made sense. So when we explained it to the guys in his cabinet that were responsible for making the building, they were on board. When we explained the economics about building it, the financial guys were on board. Now we just had to get the prints. And we did. We were very lucky to be able to have that rationalization come to this request. It's under construction, but has a long way to go. I have punished you for over an hour with all of this, so I'm going to end on something a little fun. Sometimes we do these little commercial renderings or animations, and I thought I'd show it to you today. You'll have a chuckle, we do, but sometimes they work. So I'm going to close with that. I don't know if we have time, but I'm happy to answer any questions. Thank you very much. And if you have questions, I'm happy to answer.
We do have a few minutes for questions.
Do we?
I'm sure there are at least.
I don't think there are any questions.
So if you put your hand up and wait for a microphone.
There's one over there. One question.
Hi, sorry. Just out of curiosity, when is the Kingdom Tower due to be done?
It should be done in another 3 to 4 years. We're hoping they nail it for 2020, but we'll see. It's been, it took 4 years to design it with the client. So it's been involved for, it'll be an 8 to 10 year project.
Hello. I was wondering how you weigh the sustainability costs and maximizing the space with the effects to biodiversity, and like, if I change this wind pattern, how does it affect the ecosystem in the area and those sort of factors?
Yeah. So that equation, that balanced equation, is we have certain targets or what we call key performance indicators that we're trying to achieve for the building from a sustainable standpoint. And what we're always trying to do is measure the actual functionality of the building and spaces with those KPIs. We don't let any one of those overweigh the other. So we spend a lot of time trying to figure out how to get you what you need from a functional standpoint, but in a more sustainable way. So we don't compromise space or functionality for performance. And that's where the rub is. So all of a sudden, you have to use either a more creative system or a more creative material or a technology that helps you to achieve the performance criteria without compromising the space. If we can get you more space, you know, if we can make it better and still meet the criteria, for example, on Pearl River, when I told that story about getting 5 extra floors in the building in the same height, then it's gold, right? we can find a way that all of a sudden we realize, my gosh, if we did that, the space would even, it would get even better, and it's still as sustainable or more sustainable than we want, then we're home. From an economic standpoint, we leverage the life cycle value of that space against the energy or with the energy, so we look at the entire equation as a whole, because we don't separate the two. We don't look at just cost per square foot in the building.
We have time for a couple more.
Just kind of have a down-to-earth question. Who washes these windows?
Yeah, so there's a rigging system on the buildings that have telescopic booms that come out. And we have several mechanical floors across the height of the building. They're spaced at about 30 or 60 because we feed up and down. And so they come out and the folks come down on platforms, gantries, that are supported by those booms. And there's one on each side, for example, or sometimes if they're at the top, they actually rotate and pivot around. That said, there's an issue that we think with the safety in some of these countries when they hire people, quite frankly. I remember being in Chicago and watching the guys on the ropes swing around from side to side in the Molson chairs, cleaning the windows, and I was pretty sure that those guys didn't have any insurance. So one of the things that we're working on, and we're going to hopefully knock wood execute it on a project we're doing in India, is an integrated washing system in the exterior wall so that you don't have to put people in those kinds of positions. If we can prevent someone from being hurt, we'll do it. And in India, we talked to the client about doing that, and he was all for it. So he's now sending me ideas and technology that they have that we can employ that kind of system.
Well, I think we have time for one more.
All right, so throughout the talk, it became pretty evident that the local environment is pretty heavily incorporated into your designs. How do you incorporate the possibility that in the long-term life cycle of these buildings that they're going to be in a vastly different environment? Is that incorporated?
Yeah. So that subject is huge these days in the practice of architecture and planning. It's referred to as the resiliency of the buildings to some degree. People use that word with different definitions, but we're very interested in that. In fact, the project that we're doing here in South Bend is definitely looking at that type of resilience. And what we're thinking about doing is simply creating a platform of technology that is basically a plug-and-play system, that when the technology can be replaced, it is replaced. And the environment itself is actually fairly flexible. So we're looking at kind of infill concepts as opposed to somewhat permanent. The shell itself is permanent, but we have looked at buildings that are able to be dismantled and kind of relocated or recycled or removed. But for the spaces themselves, there is lots of room for improvement in terms of the flexibility of the environments for rooms. This room, for example, is very specifically designed for this purpose, not great for a lot of other things. So when this room is empty, we want to know what we can do with this room in the moments when it's not being used, and can we transform the space? And we've done that on theater projects, obviously, but that technology, which is why we like the mixed use or the range of projects that we work on, can we take theater technology for rigging and seating and transform it, to translate it to spaces like this, where you could use this room for something else, get all the seats down, get all of them all rolled back, and have a big floor that you could do something else in here. So we're working on it. That's a great question.
Thank you so much on behalf of the faculty, staff, of the Dust College Business, and
thank
our
you.
Guests. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I appreciate it. You do. Thanks so much.